In this video, we're given a uniformly charged ring with charge Q and radius big R, and we want to find the electric field magnitude at a distance of x from the center of the ring, where the observation point lies along the ring's axis. This is also called an axial point. And the point of using an axial point is that we have wonderful symmetry in this problem. The electric field is guaranteed to point directly away from the ring along that axis. Before we begin setting things up, we need a quick note on the linear charge density, which we usually call lambda. The linear charge density is the charge per unit length, measured in coulombs per meter. So we could say the linear charge density of this ring is Q over 2 pi r, since the length of the ring is the circumference, 2 pi r. We can also say the total charge is given by the linear charge density multiplied by the length. So that charge Q could be expressed as 2 pi big R times lambda. And this idea is going to come up more than once in this video. We can always find charge by multiplying linear charge density by length. So to find the electric field at our observation point, we're going to chop this ring of charge into infinitesimal arc segments with a length that we'll call ds. Each of these little segments acts as a point charge, and this will allow us to use the standard formula for the electric field due to a point charge. Now each of these little ds's subtends an angle of d theta, and we can use the standard formula for arc length to say that ds is equal to r d theta. That's just the differential form of the usual formula for arc length, s equals r theta. Now the charge contained in that little infinitesimal arc, we'll call that dq. And dq is given by the linear charge density multiplied by the length, or lambda times ds. But replacing ds with r d theta, we can say that dq is lambda r d theta. Next, we diagram the electric field contribution made by dq. So that dq is sitting a little bit in the foreground of our picture, but we can still visualize our right triangle tilting out of the screen a little bit. One of the legs of that right triangle is given by big R, the radius of the ring. The other leg is given by x, the distance from the center of the ring to the observation point. And we're using a little r for the distance from dq to the observation point. And we can see an electric field contribution dE pointing radially away from dq. We already know that the off-axis components of E are going to cancel by symmetry. So we're only concerned with the projection of dE onto the symmetry axis. And we'll just call that dE sub x. So now if we label this angle as phi, that component dE sub x is given by dE times the cosine of phi. So now we're finally ready to use the formula for the electric field due to a point charge. So we replace dE with the formula for the field of a point charge. That's dq over 4 pi epsilon 0 r squared, because the charge that's giving us this field is dq. And to get that x component of it, we have the cosine of phi tacked on. Now there's a couple more details to deal with to get our integral set up for this problem. First, the cosine of phi is given by the adjacent leg divided by the hypotenuse. In other words, we can replace the cosine of phi with x over r, and that gives us an r cubed in the denominator now. Second, little r is given by the square root of x squared plus big R squared. We're just using the Pythagorean theorem there. So now we can replace the little r in our formula for our differential contribution to the x component of electric field. We replace that little r with square root of x squared plus big R squared. And that gives us an x squared plus big R squared to the 3/2 in the denominator. And our final step to get things set up here is that dq can be replaced with lambda r d theta. So this gives us our final expression for the differential contribution to the x component of the electric field coming from that little dq infinitesimal arc segment on the ring. Now that we have our electric field contribution written down, it's time to put our calculus hats on and use an integral to add up all the contributions. So our total electric field, that's Ex, is going to be the sum of all the electric field contributions. So that's the integral of dEx. This is what an integral does. It's a summation device for infinitely many infinitesimal contributions. So we can replace the dEx in that integral with this huge expression over on the left. And we have to ask what the integration variable is here. We see a d theta in the numerator indicating that we're integrating over theta. And we're used to having x as a variable quantity, but in this problem, x is fixed. That's a fixed distance from the center of the ring. So that's a constant in this integral. In fact, everything in this integral is a constant except for that d theta. And we're integrating as theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. So we're going around the entire ring once, chopping it into these infinitesimal segments as we go from 0 to 2 pi. So all those constants can be pulled out in front. That's a lambda r times x in the numerator, 4 pi epsilon 0 times the quantity x squared plus r squared to the 3 halves. And then we have the integral from 0 to 2 pi of d theta. The result of that integral is just 2 pi. So we can put that into the numerator. And then we recognize something in this numerator. 2 pi r is the circumference of the ring. Lambda is the linear charge density. So again, that's a way to represent the total charge of the ring. So we're going to write down the electric field as Q times X, where big Q is the total charge of the ring, over 4 pi epsilon 0 times the quantity X squared plus big R squared to the 3 halves. So there's the electric field magnitude at a distance of X from the ring on the ring's axis. Before we stop, I'd like to investigate a couple limiting cases to make sure our formula is behaving correctly. So the first case we're going to look at is the large X limit. In other words, when we get very far away from this ring, what do we expect to see, and does our formula actually produce that? So first off, what we expect to see if we're very far from this ring is that it should look like a point charge electric field where the charge is capital Q. So to make the approximation of X being much larger than the ring's radius, big R, we're looking at this term right here where we have an X squared plus R squared. If X squared is really much bigger than big R, then the R squared is negligible in that sum, and we can just ignore that. That gives us an X squared to the 3 halves, which is X cubed in the denominator. And our electric field becomes QX over 4 pi epsilon 0 X cubed. Now we can cancel one of the X's, and we arrive at the familiar formula for the electric field of a point charge, Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 X squared, where X is the distance from that point charge. So our formula for the electric field is reproducing the formula for a point charge as long as we're sufficiently far from the ring. So this gives us some more confidence that our formula is correct. Next, we investigate the small X limit. So we're saying X is much less than the ring's radius. We expect the electric field to vanish when X is literally equal to zero, because at the center of the ring, the field vanishes by symmetry. But we'll actually discover a small additional bonus when we do the work here. So again, to make this approximation, we're focused on this term where we have a sum of X squared and R squared. And if X is really much less than the ring radius, then the X squared in there is negligible. This leads us to an electric field of QX over 4 pi epsilon 0 times R cubed. And that's going to be an accurate approximation as long as X is very small. In other words, we're observing the field very close to the center of the ring itself. And so we can clearly see that if we plug in X equals 0, we get an electric field of 0. And that's great. That's what we expected. But the little bonus that I want to tack on to this is to notice that the electric field is actually growing linearly when X is very small. So the electric field is proportional to X itself. So it starts at 0 at the center of the ring, and it grows linearly. And then we know in the long run, if we look at our large X limit, that our electric field is going to level off to 0 asymptotically. So when X becomes very large, the electric field approaches 0 again. And the fact that the electric field is growing from 0 at first and then approaching 0 asymptotically when X is large means that it has to reach a maximum value somewhere in between. In the next video, we're going to compute the location of that maximum value and the maximum value of the electric field itself. That video is linked at the upper left of the end screen, and I'll see you there.